Hi everyone, welcome back to the second part of my talk on advanced methods for computationally driven drug discovery. The third application we will speak about today is developed in our lab at the University of Cagliari in collaboration with Fabio Petrucci at the Sorbonne University of Paris and Alexander Bonvin at Utrecht University. The method is based on metadynamics, that is a technique developed by Laio and Parinello in 2000. In order to force this kind of processes, so escape from free energy minima. And in particular, this is achieved in metadynamics by adding to the system a history dependent potential that is function of the so-called collective variables, that are meta coordinates, function of the coordinates of the system, that are added in the collective variable space to the conformations to the points of this space that are visited by the system. In this way, you discourage the system to visit already sampled conformations, and those years you force the exploration of the phase space. In particular, we exploit metadynamics with the hope to force the exploration of holo-like conformations of proteins starting from their upper geometries, and thus exploiting the conformational selection theory of molecular recognition. The important thing about metadynamics is that you don't need any prior knowledge about the conformation of the holo complex of the holo protein. There are several flavors of metadynamics, and we use in particular the combination of two of them. The first one is the so-called well-tempered metadynamics, in which you see here what happens relatively to the plane metadynamics. You see in this movie that basically you feel much less than what you do in standard metadynamics. Why? Because the potential is decreased over time, exponentially, and in particular you reduce the height of the Gaussians at the regions of the collective variable space that you already visited. In this way you can sample for longer time while perturbing much less the system in comparison to what you will do with plane metadynamics. You see that in the exponential formula for the height of the Gaussians, you have a factor, delta T, that has the units of a temperature. And this factor is the so-called bias factor, is used to define to which extent we want to let's say enhance the sampling in terms of height of the barriers, the overall barriers we want to cross. The important thing about the bias factor, that is defined as the ratio between delta T and T plus delta T, is that even using the well-tempered metadynamics, you can extrapolate the free energy of the process you are investigating. This is not of interest to us, but it is relevant for the validation of the method. In addition to this, we will use the so-called bias exchange metadynamics, in which you perform different simulations of the same system in parallel, applying a bias on different sets of collective variables. And from at regular time intervals, you try to exchange two consecutive replicas in the same way we have seen for replica exchange molecular dynamics, and using the same criteria. In this way, you can enhance better than in plane metadynamics the sampling of the conformational space. So our approach in a nutshell is represented here. We call it AEDIS, that stands for ensemble docking with enhanced sampling of the pocket shape. And the workflow is this one. First, you identify the binding sites on a protein of interest. You can either use experimental information or other methods. There are several servers that find the so-called druggable regions on the surface of proteins. that are putative binocyte regions. Then we enhance the sampling of different shapes and volumes of these binocytes using a novel set of collective variables that we introduced in ITIS. And we perform a multi-step cluster analysis in order to derive a set of conformations to be used in ensemble docking calculations. Then, once you identify the binding site on your protein, that in this picture is the ensemble of yellow spheres, you basically calculate the principal axis of inertia of your site, and this axis define also the so-called principal planes, principal inertia planes, that are three planes orthogonal to each other and orthogonal also to each inertia axis and passing through the geometrical center of the binding site. Once you define these planes, across each plane, you can calculate the so-called number of contacts across different between different groups of atoms, because each plane will divide the binding site in two groups of atoms, those that are on the left side of the plane in green and those that are on the right side of the plane in orange. You can calculate the number of pseudo-contacts using a sigmoidal function, okay, in which the number of contacts of each atom is calculated with all the atoms of the other group, and then you sum over all the atoms of the first group and you obtain a cumulative number of contacts that you can use to enhance the breathing of the binding site. In particular, you enhance this breathing across three independent directions, okay? And then you enhance the variation in the shape along all the three directions of the space. In addition to this, we also force the enlargement, or in this particular way, the collapsing of the collapse of the binding site by acting on the radius of gyration of the binding site. Namely, we use a window approach in which we start from the apo structure, record the value of the radius of gyration that you can see here, and we put small soft restraints on the radius of gyration in a way that we sample only conformations that are 50% higher and lower than the initial value of the radius. Then after a while, we select a random conformation that has a value of the radius of gyration lower than 5% with respect to the value of the apo structure, and we start another window, and so on and so on. In our let's say applications, we used four windows that correspond to a collapse of the binding site of 15% in terms of the radius of gyration. This value was used for all the system that I will talk about in a while, despite the different degrees of compaction of the binding site during the binding of the ligand. In particular, as test systems, we used the three proteins for which we have the holo and apo high resolution structures, and also previous computational work for using different approaches in order to test, to compare our approach with previous ones. The first system is the recombinant racing AI hydrolase that, as you can see from the comparison of the apo and holo structures in green and yellow respectively, both at the level of global conformational change and local conformational change undergo very minor structural rearrangements. Here is the ligand, you can see in black, and you see that there is only a minor change in a tyrosine of the binding site. This corresponds to a variation in terms of RMC of 1 angstrom and in terms of radius of gyration of only 1%. A recent work by Forley and collaborators investigated the performance of a recently developed variant of the famous program AutoDock, that is called AutoDock for flexible receptors, in reproducing the poses of a series of systems, including rising. And among the features of AutoDock for flexible receptors, there are the explicit selection of flexible residues and a customized scoring function. Now, despite the minor changes underwent by rising upon binding of the ligand, it was one of the few systems for which no native-like pose was found using this new developed version of AutoDock, confirming that it's a very difficult target for these programs. The second system is the beta-glucosyl transferase that binds to uracil diphosphate, and this protein undergo hinge-bending-like motions upon ligand binding. As you can see, the binding site closes on the ligand. This is clearly visible also when you compare the movement of a single amino acids. You can see in the picture here, shown by magenta arrows. And indeed, we have a change of the binding site amounting to almost 3 angstrom in terms of RMST between the upper euro conformation, and to about 10% variation in the radius of gyration. Also in this case, we have a recent computational work for comparison. This work is a paper that was published in 2010 by Seliger and de Groot, and they used an algorithm called the T-Concord to generate holo-like conformations starting from the upper structure of 10 systems, including beta-glucosyl transferase that they called gluco. They were unable to find for this particular system binding poses featuring an RMST from the experimental holo structure lower than 2 angstrom. Actually, they found only one pose out of 5,000 ones, and this pose was not among the top 100 ones. The last target that we have seen in the previous lecture is the allose binding protein, and this protein undergo even larger conformational changes upon ligand binding, as you can see also in this case from the pictures, amounting to a change in the binding site larger than 4 angstrom, and a variation in the radius of gyration of the binding site larger than 55%. 25%. Also in this case, as I said, we have a previous computational work for comparing our algorithm, and this is the work by Motta and Bonatti I discussed in the previous lecture. And now let's come to the simulations we performed with our approach. So first we performed a standard molecular dynamics of the APO system in order to compare our approach to the standard ensemble docking protocol, 10 microseconds. Then we also perform a shorter but still long 1 microsecond molecular dynamic simulation of the starting from the experimental conformation of the complex in order to verify if provided we have good conformations of the system of the protein, we are able to generate native-like poses. Then we perform, we applied our method, we performed by this change well-tempered metadynamic simulations on 4 collective variables, and for each window, we have 4 windows in total, we performed 400 nanoseconds cumulative simulation. That means that each replica was extended from, from 0 to 100 nanoseconds in each window. In addition to test the dependency of the results from the docking engine, we tested 2 famous docking programs that differ both in the searching of the native like algorithm for the native like poses, and in the scoring of the poses themselves. These are hard hoc and auto hoc. So in terms of sampling of native like structures, let's see how that does the standard MD performs. Here we are showing the comparison for beta glucosyl transferase, and in gray you see the holo experimental structure, and in red the best structure generated by the standard molecular dynamics simulation. You can see that among the features that are not reproduced by the standard MED is the displacement of this arginine that should fall apart the binding site in order to allow the ligand in gray to bind to the pocket. The best structure generated by our method is shown here in green, and you can appreciate that we are able to generate a very close conformation to the experimental one. This can be better quantified for all the system in terms of the fraction of conformations that feature low RMSD value at the binding site compared to the holo experimental structure. And you can see that only in the case of rising, the standard approach performs equally well than ITES. But for beta glucosyl transferase and for the loss binding protein, the standard approach was unable to generate any single conformation, okay, that was as close as 2 angstroms in terms of RMSD from the experimental conformation. In particular, I would like to draw your attention on the fact that these percentages that we generate with EDES are retained or even increased in the set of clusters that we generated for the docking runs. And here you can see how this better sampling, let's say, reflects in a better docking result, in better docking results, because again, only in the case of rising, we were able to find native-like poses ranked among the top 5 for using the clusters derived from standard molecular dynamics simulations. While for all the system, the conformations generated by EDES were able to give native-like poses ranked among the top 2 ones. Okay, so I hope I've shown that our method was able to perform very well for the 3 targets, studied and discussed here. And as a last example, now I will talk about how to use machine learning algorithms in order to provide a correct classification of allosteric compounds of the heat shock 90 chaperone into activators of the protein or inhibitors. This is a work that was published a few months ago and was led by Alessandro Pandini at Brunel University in London and Giorgio Colombo at Pavia University in Italy. First, a few words about allosteric binding. That is a very important process in regulating cell life. In allosteric binding, a ligand changes the functional state of the protein by binding to a site that is not the orthosteric one, so the classical site that we can think when we talk about, for instance, enzymes that are activated by substrates. So, in response to allosteric binding, a protein can change its conformational state and increase or decrease the affinity to another molecule that regulates the function of the allosteric protein. Now, it's very complex to, apply the standard theories to allosteric binding and also the standard methods for several reasons. First, it's very difficult to catch the conformational changes that derive from the binding of allosteric ligands. In addition to this, the scoring functions are generally not very good in reproducing the affinity of allosteric binders to their site. And the same is true also for experimental methods that are generally good in providing information about affinity of orthosteric sites, but they are generally also poorly informative on allosteric. Now, all these issues, let's say, sum together to the point that deriving structural activity relationship for allosteric ligands is very difficult, is much more challenging than for standard binding events. In order to develop an approach to predict allosteric binding, one should integrate information not only on the binding event, but also on the conformational dynamics of the system after the binding to an allosteric site occurs, and also how this reflects on the biological activity, okay, in particular in changing the functional state of the protein due to bind. How can be done this? Of course, there are several receipts, and the authors here propose to use machine learning models that are trained on molecular simulations data, okay, in order to predict the functional effect of allosteric binding. To be precise, they propose to use docking data and data derived from molecular dynamic simulations to train machine learning classifier in order to distinguish between activators and inhibitors of the ligand, of the protein. So the protein is shown in this slide. I told you that is the heat shock protein 90. That is a very important protein. In the active form, it's a dimer, and it's a dimer composed of monomers that you see in this slide, and the monomers are composed by three domains. The N-terminal domain that is shown in green, and this is the place where an ATP binding occurs and regulates the function of this protein. Then there is a middle domain in white, and there is a C-terminal domain in red. It has been shown that there is an allosteric site, as you can see here, the interface between the C-terminal and the middle domain, and binding of ligands to this site is able to change the functional state, and thus is able to, let's say, change the way ATP is processed. Then, in short, it changes the functional state of the protein. Now, how the authors wanted to, let's say, develop the algorithm in three steps. They first used molecular dynamic simulations starting from three experimental structures of the protein, one in complex with one activator, and two in complex with two inhibitors. And in this way, they generated a series of conformations of the protein, structural ensemble of the protein, and at the same time, since they are simulating one activator and two inhibitors, they consider potential allosteric effect, of course, under the hypothesis that actually has been demonstrated by previous studies, that even relatively short molecular dynamic simulations, such as the one they performed here, that were long a few hundreds of nanoseconds, are able to provide, to describe local rearrangements that are informative of allosteric movements of the protein. The authors employed a cluster analysis on different sets of regions of the protein in order to generate 14 representative protein structures to be used in ensemble docking calculations. The ensemble docking calculations were performed on a set of 133 compounds, chosen among those that have demonstrated activity against the chaperone protein, and in particular there are 49 inhibitors and 84 activators. The data obtained from the docking were used to train a machine learning algorithm in order to predict the functional effect of each ligand. And in particular, three features for every complex were extracted for a total of 42. First, the score of the top pose obtained by docking. Second, the root mean square of the 10 top poses for each ligand. And third, the the root mean square deviation of the atomic positions obtained from the top 10 poses for each ligand. That should give an information about the structural adaptation of the binding site during the docking calculations. Before embarking themselves into the machine learning algorithm applied to classify the ligands, the authors investigated the performance of unsupervised approaches such as cluster analysis in distinguishing between the activities of the ligands they consider. They used cluster analysis because a first analysis of the 42 features they calculated revealed, as you can see from the graphs here, that there was a very good overlap for all of the features. So in other words, we cannot identify a single feature that was able to let's say tell us, okay, this is an inhibitor, this is an activator. Then they performed a cluster analysis and they used two very famous clustering algorithms, varying the number of clusters from 2 to 6, and 2 is the most relevant because the classification we are aiming for is between activators and inhibitors, so 2 classes. And the performance was measured in terms of the so-called purity, okay, that is that takes the value of 0 if the assignment is random, and of 1 if the assignment is correct for all the ligands. The purities they obtained were pretty low, lower than 0.7 for 2 clusters with the 2 clustering methods, and so they decide to apply machine learning algorithm. As I said, the models were trained on properties that are deriving from different binding conformations. And in particular, the authors used the so-called holdout method, in which you divide your set of features your set of data into one training set that contains 70% of the data, and one test set. So you train using 70% of the data, and you test your predictor on the remaining 30% of the data. You can do this by randomizing the choice of the training set, and so you can avoid too much overfitting of your method. So the performance for 3 different approaches is shown here: logistic regression, support vector machine, and random forest. And the best and the algorithms were evaluated in terms of several parameters, including the precision, the recall, and the false positive rates. And the overall precision, the overall accuracy was higher for the support vector machine, and so we will discuss in the following only this algorithm, namely its application to distinguish the compound between activators and inhibitors of the chaperone. Now, the performance we have seen is good. Okay, because, sorry, I forgot to say that this balance accuracy is 0.89 and the maximum accuracy is 1. So the accuracy is very good. But it was obtained using an approach that didn't consider, didn't take into account the chemometrics properties, the physical chemical properties of the compounds, because the machine learning algorithm was fed by, I recall, the score, the RMS of the score, and the RMSD of the mining process. So there is no information about the, let's say, the chemistry of each compound. And so the authors decide to compare this performance to the, let's say, to the performance of approaches based on the so-called fingerprints of molecular properties. In particular, these fingerprints are, in a way, identify the properties of the different chemical groups that compose each compound. And by classifying the 133 compounds in this way, using the so-called Tanimoto coefficients, that is a very used, let's say, coefficient to classify the similarity between chemical compounds, they classify the activators into four classes and the inhibitors also into four classes. The performance of the machine learning approach is compared to the performance of this classification based on the calculation of the chemical similarities between all the compounds. It's the method they used is the ECFP method, and you can see that if we plot, as in this graph, the performance of the two approaches, okay, so chemically based and machine learning based, for each of the classes, we see that the machine learning approach performed much better for basically all the classes but the last one. Okay, so the correct classification, in other words, cannot be found from by using only fingerprints that do not consider, of course, the effect of the binding on the protein structure and dynamics, which is absolutely important for allosteric proteins. So it is not surprising, perhaps, that a method that in a way includes the impact of the binding on the dynamics for this kind of systems perform much better. Okay? And this also tells us that the specific chemotypes come out from the analysis using the machine learning approach. So, summarizing the two lectures, I think that the take-home messages are several ones. First, I hope I convinced you that computationally assisted drug design is good and improved in accuracy and predictive power in the last decades. And enhanced sampling techniques are particularly good to address challenging targets, including allosteric processes, detection of cryptic binding sites that are binding sites that are generally not occurring on the protein, and they occur only in particular situations. Also, in the case of polyspecific binding, such as in the case of some transporters that are found in bacteria and in humans, for instance. And also, take into account that you have many, many, many techniques you would like to use. And the choice depends, of course, on the application. You have to find the most suitable one for your application. This is almost always the most difficult choice to do, and you must consider the underlying theory of the method you would like to use. I think that in the case of the most difficult target, hybrid approaches can be a solution, in which you consider flexibility at different levels by combining different algorithms, for instance, in a sequential or simultaneous manner, and also when possible use experimental information if you have it, but don't forget that the use of experimental information, if that experimental information is, let's say, confined to specific chemotypes, could be also could have implications in terms of biasing the chemical space of the ligands you will select towards the space of the ligands that are part of the experimental information you have considered. So I would like I'm done, and I would like to acknowledge before closing the people that participated to the work I shown coming from our lab, in particular Paolo Ruggerone, Andrea Basciu and Giuliano Mallocci, and as I said, Fabio Pietrucci at the University of Paris and Alessandro Bonvin at the University of Utrecht, and all of you for your attention. I hope you enjoyed this lecture, and of course I will be available for questions and discussions during the summer school. Thank you.